بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه، علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما، أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم، وأنعم علينا يا عظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, here we are once again with you on Monday nights, continuing the series of the never-ending story, the stories of the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And last time, we were with you with the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, and that great story of this great messenger Yusuf alayhi salam, in which prepares the platform for all the rest of the prophets, as we'll be speaking, most of the prophets after Yusuf are from Bani Israel. With tonight, inshallah, we will be talking about the story of Musa alayhi salam. It's that great story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem over 73 times. 73 times. The story of Musa alayhi salam has been mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem as a guidance and as a reminder for all the believers of the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The story of Musa alayhi salam has many, many benefits, and it shows you the main concept of Islam and the ibadah, which is patience, as-sabr. As-sabr, patience, is the main thing of the ibadah, is to have patience. To have patience on praying, to have patience on fasting, to have patience on hajj, to have patience on paying zakat, to have patience on keeping away from the haram, to have patience on the test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests you with. So this is the story of Musa alayhi salam. And as we mentioned, the story of Yusuf alayhi salam prepares that platform for all the prophets after Yusuf alayhi salam. We mentioned that Yusuf alayhi salam is the son of Ya'qub. And we said before that Ya'qub is Israel. So Ya'qub had two names. He had Ya'qub and he had Israel. And Ya'qub is the son of Ishaq. Ishaq is the son of Ibrahim. Ya'qub alayhi salam had 12 children. 6 from one woman, 4 from another, and 2 from a third wife. And those two were Yusuf and Binyamin. And those 12 children are the children of Israel, the children of Ya'qub alayhi salam. And that's why those 12 children are named as to be Bani Israel, the children of Israel. Ya'qub alayhi salam lived in Palestine, and Yusuf alayhi salam, as his brothers plotted against him, he was taken by the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Egypt, to grow up in Egypt, and then to become the strongest man in Egypt. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to unite Yusuf alayhi salam with his other family members, with his other 11 brothers and his mother and father in Egypt. And of course, Yusuf alayhi salam, with the authority and the strength and the power and the wealth that he had in Egypt, is a lot more than what his family had in Palestine. So he called upon his family to migrate from Palestine into Egypt so they could live together under the ruling of Yusuf alayhi salam, with more wealth, more respect, better life. And that's where the nation of Bani Israel begins. So Yusuf alayhi salam is one of the children of the other 12 children of Israel alayhi salam. And when Bani Israel migrated from Palestine to Egypt, there were only 86 members. And then from those 12 brothers, which Bani Israel come from and divert back to, from those 12 brothers living in Egypt in a luxury life, knowing that Egypt is not the hometown or the homeland of Bani Israel, but it's the Egyptians who live in Egypt. It's the Egyptians, Al-Masriyin, the Egyptians who were living in Egypt, that's their homeland. And the Pharaoh that was then, back then, his name is Qabus ibn Mus'ab. Qabus ibn Mus'ab, he was very lenient towards Yusuf alayhi salam, and he was the Pharaoh, he was the king that saw from Yusuf alayhi salam the wisdom in dealing with matters, especially when interpreted his dream. So he gave him a lot of power and a lot of authority to reach to the stage that he said that I have nothing from the kingdom except the chair. Yusuf alayhi salam was running the whole country. And for Yusuf to be the one that's running the country, well, his brothers and his family will have a good settlement, they'll have a good life, they'll have a good residence in Egypt. And then from those 12 brothers, Bani Israel, or the nation of Bani Israel, will increase and increase and increase until the time of Musa alayhi salam, which you're talking about 4 to 5 generation gap, there was 600,000 Bani Israel. So they're from 86 at the time of Yusuf alayhi salam to 600,000 people from one nation called Bani Israel. Those 600,000 go back to 12 tribes, going back to those 12 brothers. So those 12 brothers are the 12 tribes of Bani Israel. They go back to their father. His name is Israel, Yaqub alayhi salam. Now after Yusuf alayhi salam, when Yusuf passed away alayhi salam and he was buried in Egypt, another king came. And then it was changed to from kingdom to become the Pharaoh, because the time of Yusuf alayhi salam was a kingdom, it was the Malik. Then after Yusuf alayhi salam, the Pharaoh came back. And the Pharaoh, the difference between the Pharaoh and the king, the Pharaoh had a lot more authority than the king. And the Pharaoh was so aggressive and he went overboard by claiming to be the Lord of the universe, where the king before him did not name or did not call himself as the Lord of the universe. At the time of Musa alayhi salam, there was another king, there was another Pharaoh. His name is Al-Walid ibn Mus'ab. Afwan, the one that was at the time of Yusuf alayhi salam, his name is Al-Rayyan ibn Al-Walid. Qabus ibn Mus'ab was the brother of Al-Walid ibn Mus'ab, that later on, after Qabus passed away, his brother Al-Walid ibn Mus'ab took over the kingdom of Egypt. And Al-Walid ibn Mus'ab was so tyrant. He was so tyrant, so oppressive, unjust, that he forced his lordship over people. And he was claiming to be the Lord of the universe. He is the Lord of the East and the West. And he is the Lord of the universe. And he is the one with authority. And he's the one that created the world and created the heavens, created the earth. And he was so tyrant that he was unjust in the way he was ruling and everything, the way he dealt with the government. And he hated Bani Israel. He couldn't see Bani Israel living in the same territory or living in the same land or the same country. So what he did, he started to divide people into different categories. And he put the Egyptians as to be the highest category. They are the most respectful ones, and they are the ones with wealth, with authority, with kingdom, with respect. And he put Bani Israel as the lowest category, and they are the slaves of the Egyptians. He made Bani Israel to be the slaves of the Egyptians, and he forced slavery upon them. He made their men, their males, to be the male slaves, and their women to be the she slave or the female maid or the slave. So he was so tyrant, so oppressive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal mentions this story in the Quran al-Kareem. Inna fir'auna ala fil ardi wa ja'ala ahlaha shi'an yastad'ifu ta'ifatan minhum yudhabbihu abna'ahum wa yastahyi nisa'ahum. Allah azza wa jal says that Fir'aun became so big on earth, of course on earth, but nothing in the hereafter, but so low in the hereafter. Fir'aun became so strong, so powerful on earth. وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا. And he divided people. He made people in different categories. Egyptians, al-Masriyin, are the ones with authority and respect. Anyone beside that? They are second class or second category. The Bani Israel are the slaves. They are full on slaves. And when you talk about a slave, that means you own him. This man, I own him. I own this woman. They're my property. I do with them what I want to do with my other properties. So that's how the customs, or that's how Fir'aun, la'natullah alayhi, enforced this oppressive and this unjust way or methodology in Egypt. Now, also, this Fir'aun at the time of Musa alayhi salam, in which we said his name is Al-Walid ibn Mus'ab, he married a righteous woman. And this righteous woman, her name is Asiya bint Muzahim. And this righteous woman was forced to marry him because he threatened her father, if she does not marry him, not only he'll kill her, but he'll kill the whole family. And the father came to his daughter and saying, "Oh daughter, you have the option between you getting married to him and have patience on this tyrant man, or get us all killed, including yourself and myself." So Asiya, alayha salam, she had no other option or other choice except to accept the marriage of this Pharaoh. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, كَمُلَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ كَثِيرٌ وَلَمْ يَكْمُلْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ إِلَّا أَرْبَعٌ. That a lot of men became so perfect or became complete in their wisdom, in their understanding, in their strength. But not many women became complete except four. And from those four, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Asiya bint Muzahim. And inshallah, we'll hear the great sacrifice that Asiya sacrificed for the sake of believing in one Lord and following the path of Musa alayhi salam. One night, this Pharaoh, this tyrant Pharaoh, will see an amazing dream. He will see a fire coming from Bayt al-Maqdis, Jerusalem, Palestine, coming towards Egypt, burning every single house in Egypt except the Bani Israel or the Israeli houses. And then the Pharaoh wake up so scared, frightened, feels threatened. And he felt that this dream has an interpretation. And that interpretation means a lot for him. And keep in mind, my brothers and sisters, at the time of Musa alayhi salam, at the time of this Pharaoh, it was a time of magic and magicians and a lot of fortune tellers. It was a time where there was a lot of magicians, a lot of fortune tellers, and people will be dealing with magic, and the magicians had respect in society. As we live now in time and era where the doctor, the engineer, the politician has respect. Before, it used to be the sheikh and the imam has respect, now it's turned around. Every time and era you get where certain type of people are the ones with respect. So at the time of Musa alayhi salam, it was those who dealt with magic, with fortune tellers, they were those with respect. They were those who were kept around the king, or kept around the pharaoh, kept around the politicians and the ministers. So this pharaoh, when he saw this dream, he knew this, and there's a message from behind that dream. So he went and asked his fortune tellers, he went and asked the magicians around him, and they interpret that dream as to be that there will be a new baby born from Bani Israel, who will be born very soon. Your ending will come on his hands. And you'll end on his hands. This child from Bani Israel will be born very soon. And of course it's going to be a male, because a female can't handle that. So it's a male baby from Bani Israel will be born very soon. And the end of your kingdom will come on his hands. So this Pharaoh got so scared. And what did he do? He came up with a law that any new baby that's born from Bani Israel, and it's a male, kill him. So he sent out his troops, his soldiers, killing every single child that's born from Bani Israel if it's a male. And that's where Allah Azza wa Jalla said, يُقَتِّلُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. He kills their baby boy, children, and he leaves their female children or the female babies alive. يَسْتَحِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. He leaves them alive. And his soldiers went around, especially in the houses of Bani Israel, And keep in mind, my brothers and sisters, the houses of Bani Israel in Egypt were distinguished. They were living in a certain area or a certain suburb. They were living in a certain way of life, so they were distinguished. But it's not that easy to know which woman is pregnant or not. And who would know most? Who would know most are the women who are given are the women who help the pregnant woman give birth. Are the women who help the pregnant woman go through their pregnancy. Are the women who are working in the field. So he sent out an order that any woman that knows of a female from Bani Israel being pregnant and she does not inform that, she'll be killed. So what happened? All women got scared. All the women got scared, and any woman that knew about her neighbor, any new woman that knew about another female from Bani Israel being pregnant, she started to go and just mention that, I know this lady, she's pregnant. I know this lady from Bani Israel, she's pregnant. Because they were afraid on themselves. And here, Fir'aun, la'natullah alayhi, will destroy and kill any new baby boy that's born from Bani Israel. From among those, it was the mother of Musa alayhi salam that was pregnant. And her first month of pregnancy, as we all know, that the first month does not really show as much as it shows after 4 or 5 months. When she knew she was pregnant, she isolated herself from everyone and she stayed at home. She doesn't want to let anyone know that she's pregnant, and she's scared on her child. And then months will go past, and the mother of Musa alayhi salam, protecting her child in her womb, does not want to know anyone, does not want to know, let anyone know about her pregnancy. And then it came to the time in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted her to give birth. And here she gives birth to a baby boy. And that's the more frightening thing, that if it's a baby boy, he's going to be killed. And she's got to hide her child in any way without anyone knowing. But the thing is, this is a child. He'll cry all night and people will know. Hold on a sec. There's a child next door. We didn't know about her having a child. People will know. And their houses weren't as isolated as our houses these days. Their houses were stuck to each other. And of course, their houses were made out of mud or clay, that there's not much of a sound prevention between the walls. So Musa alayhi salam became so scared on his son. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and we had inspired the mother of Musa to breastfeed him. Of course, he needs to be breastfed, or else he'll die from hunger. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي. فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمِّ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي إِنَّ رَادُّهُ إِلَيْكِ وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired the mother of Musa, saying to her, informing her to breastfeed her son and not to be afraid, not to be scared. And if she really gets scared over her son, she's afraid over the news to be exposed of her giving birth to a baby boy, then put your son in a basket and cast him in the river and leave the rest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. Don't be afraid and don't be sad. إِنَّ رَادُّهُ إِلَيْكَ. We will bring him back to you. He'll come back to you. But sacrifice this sacrifice for us. Show us your heart. And this is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah wants to give a reward to one of his servants, Allah would not give you the reward until you sacrifice for it. It's not just going to come like that. So Allah Azza wa Jal told her, by inspiration, فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَامِ. Put him in a basket and cast him in the river. And there was the Nile River then. And the Nile River is the largest and longest river in the world. فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَامِ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. Don't be afraid and don't be sad. إِنَّ رَادُّهُ إِلَيْكَ. We'll bring him back to you. Don't worry, he'll come back to you. وَجَاعِلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And we're going to make him from the messengers. Allahu Akbar. What more can a mother ask for? She'll sacrifice that. But at the end of the day, she's still a mother with a new baby. She's still passionate and emotional over her son. So she put him in that basket, protecting her son from the water floating into him. And she casted this basket in the middle of the river. And the river took him. And when you talk about the Nile River, it's not a small width or short width river. It's a very wide river. It's like I see when you look at it. It's very wide in kilometers. So the river took this basket. And who's inside that basket? Musa alayhi salam. And the mother of Musa was so afraid on her son that she told her daughter, وَقَالَتْ لِأُخْتِهِ قُصِّيهِ. Follow him. Follow this basket and see where this basket will land. And who is the mother of Musa running away from? Who is she trying to hide? Who is she trying to hide her son from? From the Pharaoh. So where did the basket land? It landed in front of the palace of the Pharaoh. This whole fear is about Musa alayhi salam not going in the hands of the soldiers of the Pharaoh. So where did this basket land? It landed in the palace of Pharaoh. Subhanallah. This is how Allah Azza wa Jalla works, ikhwani. It's not what you see. It's not what you see. It's what Allah wants. Allah Azza wa Jalla will make the impossible possible. And that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's how Allah Azza wa Jalla deals with this creation in this dunya with hikmah and wisdom. But this hikmah and wisdom is above our imagination and our wisdom and our way of thinking. And for that, the one that the mother of Musa is trying to protect Musa from, he landed in front of her palace. And who picks him up? One of the slaves of the wife of the Pharaoh. And what do they see inside that basket? Someone, a little baby. And from his looks, he looks like Bani Israel. So it wasn't hidden. It was known. It was known to them that this kid is from Bani Israel. The way he looks, his color, his skin, it's recognizable. I don't think sometimes it's hard to distinguish a child from another child. And then the slaves, the maids of the palace will bring this basket with the baby to Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun. And Asiya, alayha salam, Asiya was a barren woman. She couldn't give birth. And of course, as time goes, she is eager and encouraged to have a child. And when she saw this child coming out of nowhere, she felt that this is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how is she going to face the Pharaoh? Especially when the Pharaoh looks at him, he's going to know he's from Bani Israel. So she went up to the Pharaoh and she said to him, قُرَّةُ عَيْنٍ لِي وَلَكْ عَسَىٰ أَن نَتَّخِذَهُ وَلَدْ. Maybe let's take him as a child. He'll be a delight for me and you. He'll be something, a happiness for me and you. So what did the Pharaoh say? He said, he is a delight and happiness for you, not for me. So I'm sending my soldiers around to kill these kids. And now he's coming to live inside my palace. قُرَّةُ عَيْنٍ لِي وَلَكْ. He told her, قُرَّةُ عَيْنٍ لَكِ لَيْسَ لِي. It's a delight and happiness for you, not for me. There is a narration that's been mentioned that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if he said, قُرَّةُ عَيْنٍ لِي وَلَكْ, if he said, yes, for me and you, Allah Azza wa Jalla would have not made the ending of the Pharaoh on the child's hand. But he said, he's a delight for you, not for me. Happiness for you, not for me. A comfort for you, not for me. He's your child, not mine. And Asiya, of course, she accepted as a believing woman, of course. And the Pharaoh, as I mentioned, he knows he's from Bani Israel. But he said, what's the chances of this kid to be the one that my ending will come in his hands? Well, the chances were 100%. 100% that he is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use from inside your palace to destroy you and destroy your kingdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَالْتَقَطَهُ آلُ فِرْعَوْنَ لِيَكُونَ لَهُمْ عَدُوًا وَحَزَنًا. The family of Fir'aun, they're the ones who captured and found Yusuf and Musa alayhi salam. And Allah says, لِيَكُونَ لَهُمْ عَدُوًا وَحَزَنًا. So this child becomes an enemy and a sadness on Fir'aun and his army. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا كَانُوا خَاطِئِينَ. Fir'aun and Haman was the right-hand man of Fir'aun. He was the devil that used to always whisper in the mind of Fir'aun. Hatta even some scholars were saying Haman was worse than Fir'aun. Because he's the one that used to always put these things in the mind of Fir'aun. وجنودهما and their soldiers كانوا خاطئين. They were all mistaken. They were all wrong. They're all wrongdoers. They're all wrongdoers. Why? Because they were planning against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are plotting against Islam. They are plotting against Allah's will. So they are mistaken. No doubt they are mistaken. And he, Musa alayhi salam, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a child, will stay in the house of Fir'aun. But this is a baby. It needs to breastfeed. So what did the wife of Fir'aun do? She called upon all the breastfeeding women. Back then, breastfeeding women used to hire themselves for breastfeeding the child and get money in return. Because of poverty, of course. So many of the breastfeeding women came to the palace saying, you know, this is the son or the child of the Pharaoh. We'll breastfeed him and get a lot of money. So many of them came to the palace of the Pharaoh trying to breastfeed Musa. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَحَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِ الْمَرَاضِعَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and we forbade Musa alayhi salam from suckling on any breast. This is a hikmah. Why? Because Allah wants to fulfill His promise to His mother. Inna raduhu ilayk, we're going to bring him back to you. Don't worry. So what did the wife of the Pharaoh Asya alayhi salam do? She sent out Musa to the market and asking anyone in public who could breastfeed this child. This child's going to die from hunger and he's not accepting any breast. Who heard that? His sister. So his sister came and she said, I know a family, a mother. I guarantee you, if he sees her, he'll drink from her, he'll breast from her. He'll breastfeed from her. So the father, what guarantee? She said, I know this woman. No child has he ever came across this woman and did not accept her breast. So when Musa alayhi salam came to the mother or his original mother, he grabbed onto the breast of his mother and he started to breastfeed. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, what did he say? وكذلك Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَرَدَدْنَاهُ إِلَىٰ أُمِّهِ. We returned him back to his mother. كَيْ تَعْلَمَ كَيْ تَقَرَّ عَيْنُهَا وَلَا تَحْزَن. So her heart and her eyes be delighted and not to be sad. وَلِتَعْلَمَ أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٍ. So she knows that the promise of Allah is truth. When Allah promises, Allah fulfills His promise. Allah's promise is always the truth. Allah is the one that fulfills His promise. His promise is not like any of His creation. But Allah, when He makes a promise, He fulfills His promise. And Allah, when Allah makes a promise, that when you sacrifice for Him, Allah Azza wa Jalla will reward you a great reward. Allah's promise will be fulfilled. But the fulfillment of this promise doesn't have to be now. And that's where we all fall into. Allah promised me. But did Allah say it to you now? Could be later, soon. But 100% Allah will give it to you in the hereafter. فرددناه إلى أمه كي تقر عينها ولا تحزن ولتعلم أن وعد الله حق ولكن أكثرهم لا يعلمون. But many of them don't know. Before Musa alayhi salam came into the hands and the arms of his mother was so upset. The mother of Musa alayhi salam was so upset, so sad, so frightened on Musa alayhi salam. What would you think if you were in her position? That's it. My son has been killed. The one that's the killer or the one that I'm running away from, Musa ended up in his hands. That's it, my son is gone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَى فَارِغًا. The heart of the mother of Musa has been so empty. إِنْ كَادَتْ لَتُبْدِ بِهِ. She was going to go out and start screaming in front of everyone, my son, my son. She's gonna disclose her secret that she's been hiding for many months. لَوْلَا أَرَّبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهَا. Allah says, if it wasn't for us grabbing onto her heart, grabbing, making her have patience, لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, so she could be from among those who believe. So she reached to that stage where she was going to explode, as we say. She was going to go and disclose her secret that she's been hiding for a long time, from the passion and the emotions towards her son. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَوْلَا رَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهَا. We grabbed onto her heart. We made her firm. We made her strong. Why? So she could become from among the believers. And now Musa alayhi salam is in a 5-star luxury in the house of the Pharaoh, in the palace of the Pharaoh. And Musa alayhi salam will grow. And he grows a very healthy growth. Very strong, very tough. They say that Musa alayhi salam had the strength of 10 men. And you'll hear that very soon. When Musa alayhi salam became an adult at the age of 18, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, ولما بلغ أشده واستوى آتيناه حكما وعلما. When Musa alayhi salam became adult, mature, and he became strong, Allah azza wa jal said, we gave him the wisdom and the knowledge. Of course, the wisdom and the knowledge, not the prophecy. But Allah Azza wa Jal given him wisdom. He was wise. He was smart in the way he dealt with things. He was wise in the way he tackled matters. And Musa alayhi salam was known to be the son of the king or the Pharaoh. This is where everyone took him as to be. And when Fir'aun used to be out of the palace, it was Musa alayhi salam used to run that palace that later on Musa is going to destroy. Musa alayhi salam is the one that used to run and take care of the matters of the palace. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this preparation, Allah now wants to prepare Musa for his mission. Oh, what's his mission? To become a businessman, to become a king. His mission what? To become an actor. His mission to become a singer, to become a famous person in the corruption. His mission is to save people from the corruption. His mission is to call to Allah Azza wa Jal. His mission is to remind people about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His mission is to call people to submission of one Lord, Allah Almighty. And now the preparation comes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَدَخَلَ الْمَدِينَةَ عَلَىٰ حِينِ غَفْلَةٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا فَوَجَدَ فِيهَا رَجُلَيْنِ يَقْتَتِلَانِ. During midday, Musa alayhi salam is walking in the middle of the city of Egypt. And during midday, back then people used to sleep. And many customs, many people have this custom, many cultures, many countries have this custom of sleeping during the day or midday, especially when the sun is in the middle of the skies. There's no shelter, so it will be very tough and hard for people to work. So it was their custom back then for them to go to sleep, have a short nap during midday. He was out, Musa alayhi salam was in the out walking in the middle of the city of in Egypt. And who did he see? He said, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَوَجَدَ فِيهَا رَجُلَيْنِ يَقْتَتِلَانِ. He found two men fighting against each other. هَذَا مِنْ شِيَعَتِهِ وَهَذَا مِنْ عَدُوِهِ. One of those men is from Bani Israel, from the tribe or the family of Musa alayhi salam. وَهَذَا مِنْ عَدُوِهِ. And the other one is from the Egyptians. And everyone knew Musa alayhi salam was from Bani Israel. He looks it, he speaks it, he lives it, he's from Bani Israel. And those two men, the Egyptian and the Israeli, they were fighting against each other. So the Egyptian, because he's got the upper hand over the Israeli, he was so arrogant, so rude, so aggressive towards the Bani the Israeli. So Musa alayhi salam came to stop the fight. And Musa was so tough. He was so strong. But Musa did not know the strength of his toughness and strength. He didn't know how strong he was. So he came and pushed the Egyptian. But that push was like a bulldozer that hit him and made him die. He pushed him like how one of us will push. Who could imagine that if I push this person, he's going to die? But Musa alayhi salam did not evaluate his strength. He didn't know. He did not calculate his strength. He hasn't experienced his strength. So he pushed the Egyptian and that push killed him. But subhanallah. This is something that Musa alayhi salam, and Musa was a mu'min. Musa is not a disbeliever. He's not someone that wants to do the corruption or haram. He's a future prophet. And no doubt that he would not have one single inch in his heart that he'll care about doing such a corruption, killing someone. So Musa alayhi salam, when he did that, فَوَكَزَهُ مُوسَى فَقَضَ عَلَىٰ قَالَ هَذَا مِنْ عَمَلَ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ عَدُوٌ مُضِلْمٌ. When Musa pushed the Egyptian and he killed him, Musa was shocked. He said, this is from the action of the shaitan. Now why I could do something like this? Shaitan maybe whispered in me and made me push him this way, but I did not know that it would lead to that. إِنَّهُ عَدُوٌ مُضِلْمٌ مُبِينٌ. The shaitan is an enemy and he's a misguider, and he's a very clear misguider and very clear evident enemy. But who knows that? And then there was three present. Musa, the Israeli, and the Egyptian. Now the Egyptian is dead. Who knows about it? Only the Israeli. And what did Musa alayhi salam? Musa alayhi salam hid himself. He said, you know, now if they know I did that, it's enough that I had a grudge over me for the last 18 years, knowing that I'm from Bani Israel, living in the house. and the palace of the Pharaoh, they're just waiting for something like this to happen. Especially the Pharaoh himself, he hates him, but he was forced to keep him there. So he's waiting for some wrong, for such a wrong that happened, for this to make the Pharaoh kill him or get rid of him. And Musa alayhi salam, he made dua, قال ربي إني ظلمت نفسي فغفر لي فغفر له إنه الغفور الرحيم. He said, oh my Lord, I had wronged myself, I had done something wrong, so forgive me. And Allah Azza wa said, Allah had forgiven him, he is the most forgiving, the most merciful. And then he said, Musa قال ربي بما أنعمت علي فلن أكون ظهيرا للمجرمين. Oh Allah, for what you had favored, for what you had given me, what for what you have favored or gifted me, I will not never more to be the supporter of the mujrimeen or the oppressors or the wrongdoers or the criminals. Yani he knows that Allah had given him a gift. That gift is a gift of strength. And he said, ya Allah, this gift that you had given me, I would never use it for what displeases you, O my Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, فَأَصْبَحَ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّمْ. Musa now, he knows he done a crime. He done a crime by Allah Azza wa Jalla, and he done a crime within Egypt. He knows he done this crime. But now, Allah had forgiven him. But in Egypt, if they know he's the one that killed the Egyptian, then there'll be a great retaliation. There'll be a severe retaliation. So Musa alayhi salam is scared, frightened, hiding himself, trying to keep away from the appearance in front of people. And then the next day, same time, while he was walking, he saw the same Israeli that he stood by yesterday fighting against another Egyptian. Subhanallah, now you put yourself in his position. If I'm not going to support this Israeli, he'll go and drop me in. He'll be the first one to go and tell people about me. And if I do support him, it looks like this Israeli, he's the one in the wrong. Yesterday he had a fight, today again. And he's the mishkelja, as we say. He's the one with the problems. So Musa alayhi salam, as Allah says, فَإِذَا الَّذِي اسْتَنْصَرَهُ بِالْأَمْسِ يَسْتَصْرِخُهُ. While he's walking, the same Israeli that Musa stood by yesterday is calling upon Musa, come and help me. Tough situation for Musa alayhi salam. قَالَ لَهُ مُوسَى إِنَّكَ لَغَوِيٌّ مُبِينٌ. When Musa looked at the Israeli, he said, indeed, you are misguided and you are hot-headed. You are misguided and you are hot-headed. Looks like it's from you. But what's Musa going to do? فَلَمَّا أَنْ أَرَادَ يَبْتَشَ بِالَّذِي هُوَ عَدُوٌ لَهُمَا. Musa alayhi salam, there's two interpretations to this verse. When Musa came to support and fight with the Israeli against the Egyptian told him, oh Musa, قَالَ يَا مُوسَى تُرِيدُ أَنْ تَقْتُلَنِي كَمَا قَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا بِالْأَمْسِ. Oh Musa, do you want to kill me the way you killed someone yesterday? So the news was out that it was Musa alayhi salam that killed the Egyptian. Another interpretation of the verse, some scholars say when Musa alayhi salam came to fight against the Egyptian with the Israeli thought after what Musa told him, he thought that Musa is going to come and hit him. And this Israeli knows the push of Musa alayhi salam. So what did the Israeli say in front of the Egyptian? Oh Musa, do you want to come and kill me the way you killed someone yesterday? So that Egyptian heard and he ran and he told everyone. So there's two interpretations to the verse. Knowing that at the end that the news went out that Musa alayhi salam is the one that committed that crime of killing the Egyptian the day before that. إن تريد إلا أن تكون جبارا في الأرض وما تريد أن تكون من المصلحين. He responded, he said that you only want to be a tyrant, oppressive person on earth, and he don't want to be from those who do the wrongdoing, from those who do the right doing. And the news went around. Musa is the one that killed the Egyptian. Musa is the one that committed that crime. Musa is the one that did this. Musa is the one that done that. Now we have to retaliate. We have to make Musa pay the price. And the news is out there, and the soldiers now are looking for Musa alayhi salam, for this criminal. وَجَاءَ رَجُلٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ مِّنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا مُوسَى إِنَّ الْمَلَأَ يَأْتَمِرُونَ بِكَ لِيَقْتُلُوكَ فَاخْرُجْ إِنِّي لَكَ مِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. One of the Egyptians who used to love Musa, like Musa, he heard, and he's one of the close ones to the family, or the close ones to the Pharaoh, he heard that the soldiers are out there to take Musa and capture him, and lock him up and make him pay a big price for his crime. He came to Musa looking for him, and he told him, oh Musa, everyone is looking for you. Even the soldiers are looking for you. The police are looking for you to kill you. For what you had did or you have done a few days ago, فَخْرُجْ إِنِّي لَكَ مِنَ النَّاصِحِ. I advise you to leave the city and go out. Go somewhere where no one knows about you. So Musa alayhi salam, in that situation, he had nothing except to leave the city. And he left Egypt alayhi salam, traveling towards Palestine. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says,
فَخَرَجَ مِنْهَا خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبْ قَالَ رَبِّ نَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ.
He went out with fear, scared, looking around. Is there anyone following him? And then he said, رَبِّ نَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. Oh Allah, save me from the wrongdoing people. Ya Allah, save me from the oppressive people. Ya Allah, save me from these people. And then he went towards a city by the name of Madian. Madian is the city of the righteous prophet and messenger Shu'aib alayhi salam, where Musa alayhi salam now will start a new phase, a new era in Madian, away from the people of Egypt, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now prepares him for the prophecy, and Allah azza wa jalla prepares him for the great mission. As Musa alayhi salam was from ulul azmi min ar-rusul, those prophets and messengers who really were steadfast and patient, and the strong prophets and messengers who were strong and firm. Now, inshallah, we'll continue with that next Monday here at Lakemba Mosque. We see you then. Before we finish, inshallah, this Thursday and the two Thursdays after this Thursday, so three Thursdays, we will be holding the marriage course. Marriage course for all brothers and sisters this Thursday after Salat al-Isha. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma ihdina wa ihdi bina wa ja'alna sababan liman ihtada. Allahumma ihdi ummata Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma aslih ummata Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ighfir li ummati Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wal muslimin. Allahumma izz al-Islam wal muslimin. Allahumma man arada bil Islam wal muslimin khayran fawaffiqhu li kulli khayr wa man arada bihim ghayra dhalika fakhudhu akhdha azizan muqtadir. Allahumma atina fid dunya حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. يا مصرف القلوب والأبصار صرف قلوبنا إلى طاعتك. وفقنا لما تحبه وترضاه. استخدمنا لدينك ورفع راية نبيك. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. نسألك من خير ما سألك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
To listen to or download more Islamic lectures, please visit www.islamicmedia.com.au.